Hello, you malty mistresses. I'm Ralphie. This is my Manx Bothy, where I do whisky reviews. And do you know what? You're just in time, because we're about to start Whisky Review 379. But first of all, thanks to Horst Schuller for the malt mention, the contributory malt mention, introducing a review on a blended scotch called William Lawson's 12-year-old, bottled at 40%. And you know you're obviously going a bit more upmarket as regards your blended whisky. Why? Because it comes with a box. That's why. In my previous review, 378, I reviewed this standard entry level William Lawson's blended scotch whisky, and in my opinion, it's a good blend. It's light, fruity, no peat, no big heavy notes, no complications, simple, direct, practical, light, fruity blended scotch. And as I said, in my previous review, a good way of kind of really pinning this one down is, if someone was to say to me, Ralphie, I like Jameson's, but I want a Scottish option to Jameson's, well, this is what I would suggest William Lawson's. Noted for the fact that it's got a very unstuffy, unpretentious approach to marketing. It's humorous, entertaining adverts, and it's not too far up its own arse as regards its heritage and provenance and all the other kind of flannel that you can get with some other brands. So we'll pop this bottle to the side, seeing as this is the one we're reviewing, the 12-year-old. I'm a bit of a fan of the 12-year-old blends because they're a step up from the basic. People tend to go for the basics with the blends because they're bought for mixing, they're bought for drinking in tumblers with ice. But see, with the 12-year-old, you're getting a little bit extra for not too much of an extra cost, depending where you are. You know you're going up market because you get a box, a presentation box with the bottle. It's not out there on its own. 12-year-old. I should be getting a little bit more oak involvement, and considering that this is a relatively light blend, fresh fruit, barley sugar, touch of yeastiness, but no peat, then any oak involvement should be fairly prominent. Initially, quite a quiet, subdued, gentle, fruity nose. Certainly much more smooth. Sorry, I'll rephrase that. I hate the word smooth. A much more mature nose, lacking the spiritiness of the younger version of William Lawson's, because this has had full 12 years. Both grain and malt, all the whiskies involved, a full 12 years plus maturation, which has tempered and rounded off the harsher, edgier, more youthful notes. Really enjoying that little marzipan nutty extra that you're getting with the 12-year-old, and you're certainly, I'm noticing some pretty clean, fresh, good quality, principally American oak. I'm noticing it with the vanilla. Intense, fresh fruit, slightly sherried. Okay, I'll give it that. Slightly sherried. American oak. Now, this may seem a contradiction, but bear in mind, sherry casks can be made using American oak, whereas American casks are rarely used, made using European oak, although it has been known. Coffee, mixed spices, cardamom. So getting a bit of spiciness coming in with the oak. Oak wood, vintage cider, rice wine, clove, mint, camphor, menthol, cola. And with the addition of some water, a little drop of water, not much. Just a drop. Give it a few minutes in the glass, and then you'll get some cereal hay and field clover coming through. So what I'm noticing in the nose alone is that really Give it a bit of time, let it settle down, open up. You're getting quite a lot of delivered in terms of smell. Reminiscent of a sort of Balvenie Glengoyne, actually. Oh, there's that marzipan slight walnut note there. And lovely. Taste wise, with you in a minute. Can't rush it. I've tasted worse single malts. Definitely. Quite in something that kind of jumps out a little bit is the influence of the grain whiskey. That's the corn whiskey from the Column Stills, as against the malt whiskey from the pot stills. It takes you a while to realise that the corn whiskey stroke wheat whiskey, the grain whiskey, is making quite a significant contribution and a positive contribution to this blend. Fresh fruit syrup, barley sugar, vintage cider again, cola cubes, gooseberry, kiwi fruit, mint, and funnily enough, there's a touch of savoury note of celery. But you're also getting that slight brown sugar, brulee, toasted toffee note that you get from corn whiskey. And what I find intriguing is that I think a lot of the oak influence in this 12-year-old William Lawson's is not in fact coming from the malt whiskey, it's coming from the corn whiskey, the grain whiskey. Touch of maple there. Interesting, it's a kind of sweet and sour. Quietly done, restrained, but a busy whiskey. Finish, barley sugar, mint, cola, vanilla, and some mild but reasonably rich oak wood. A rounded and characterful blend. Really quite balanced with the oak involved. You know, the oak at this age of blended whiskey is actually much more active, balanced, and engaged in the smell and the flavour than I've noticed with many single malts. It's a blend mark, of course, and the mark is 89 out of 100. A very interesting Scotch whisky indeed, and very interesting to, I mean, I made a deliberate decision to record this review immediately after recording this review, so as that you would get that kind of comparison between the two whiskies. You can also get a 13-year-old William Lawson's bourbon cask matured, but there's not so much of that around, but an interesting whisky as well. I've made a wee note here just to confirm that I've found from experience that all blended whiskies at 12 years old tend to be quite a significant jump in quality and sippability compared to the standard young versions, which are really produced as mixing whiskies or whiskies to have in a tumbler with ice. It's just the reality of it. But I also find it quite engaging about the fact that single malts, and that's why I have single malt and blend marks separate, single malts are a whiskey made exclusively from 100% malted barley, either double or triple distilled in pot stills. Blended scotch, not blended malt, but blended scotch is a combination of corn, wheat, any grain can be used. Whisky made through continuous stills, which is generally more refined, and particularly if corn's involved, you've got a different weight, a different texture to the whisky. You've got a different character completely between grain whisky from column stills in Scotland and malt whisky from pot stills. And therefore, when you combine the two spirits together, they don't relate to each other the way two malts would when they're put together. So in fact, I think it's only right that we actually consider blended, traditional blended grain and malt whisky, Scotch whisky, to be a different spirit, a cousin, but really not the same as a single malt whisky, because the actual ingredients used and the whole process essentially is different, fundamentally different. I mean, you don't get more different than pot stills and continuous column stills. They are hugely different. And although you can produce malted barley spirit from continuous stills, again, it's different from that produced in pot stills. And therefore, it's tempting, particularly if one is a malt snob, to say malt superior to traditional Scotch blend always is. Well, it's easy to say that because it's simply a different spirit. And it's often the case that people will too closely link single malt and traditional Scotch together. One involves the other, but I do recommend you look out for, you'll find this in independent bottlings. Independent bottlers do it. Signatory and Cadenhead and Gordon MacPhail and all the rest of them. They do Scotch single grain distilleries from distilleries such as Cambus, Cameron Brigg, Strathclyde, Port Dundas, Carsbridge. Carsbridge, by the way, is the finest grain whisky from Scotland. It's virtually invisible now. Duncan Taylor had some great versions of it. I think the only place you can find it, source it now, is Clandenny, which is part of Lang's, the Lang brothers, independent bottlers. But some of these old grain whiskies, particularly for the price, they can be a fantastic experience and much better value for money than some single malts. So don't dismiss them out of hand. Old Scotch grain whisky can really stand out on its own, and it's an opportunity for you to gain experience from blending old grain with young single malt, and just seeing how, once you've married them together, how spectacular the results can be. But I tell you what makes this quite spectacular is when you take your traditional blended Scotch of good quality and add a little bit of good quality single malt. I've done vlogs about how to do this, and I've made recommendations, and I'm just mentioning it again as a reminder. Feel free to pick and mix and play around with your whiskies, rums, bourbons, whatever spirit you're enjoying. Feel free to play with them, mix them up, try them in different glasses, blend your own, because that's when you really learn so much about how the industry do it, and you can pick out when it's working and when it's not. Wee drop of Laphroaig in this 12-year-old William Lawson's. Love their adverts, by the way, I do. Humorous, self-effacing, not too pompous and bombastic, and frankly, fake, like some big whiskey ads can be. Or just downright boring. Doesn't taste like Laphroaig's been added. It tastes like something different. It'd be hard to pin it down, actually. Anyway, thank you for watching. I'm going to spend a bit more quality time with this, see how I get on with it. Perhaps add a bit more water, because it was cask strength Laphroaig added. So I hope you'll join me again shortly for Whisky Review 380, in which I will be continuing with another blended Scotch whisky with a silly name called Hanky Bannister. See you soon, malt mates. Sip safely.